So this is your video on the Magician card today. The Magician card is a little bit intenser and as the Fool. So bear with me. It might be a longer video. We're going to move through at a pretty quick pace. So I'll try to be fast, but not too fast. Okay, so the Magician card. I do have a couple that I wanted to show you. And one is, for example, from the Wild Unknown Tarot by Kim Krantz. You can see how beautifully she's integrated the typical colors of the Magician, which is yellow into orange. Then she's got the four suits of Sword, Pentacles, Cups, and Wands. Also the lemniscate, or the eternity symbol, on the chest of this jaguar or leopard. And the number one, it's ascribed to the number one. Then we've got from the Scapini Tarot, and Luigi Scapini created this tarot. It's really beautiful. It's collaged and expanded with his own artwork from medieval depictions, from true medieval images. So we have here the classic red of the Magician as well, and the four symbols. And then we have here Anna Kay, and we see how the Magician is working energy. And the four suits as well. So Cups, Wands, Pentacles, and Swords. So let's dive into this, the Magician card, because we've got a lot of ground to cover here. Okay, we start off with a classic. Please look it up, who created this, what the basis is of this tarot and the background, because it's really foundational tarot knowledge, but it would take too long in these videos. We've got the Rider-Waite card here, and everything on this card is a symbol. So we've got the roses, which are experience, right? Experience through pain, kind of. But we've got the yellow of the mental world, the white of purity, the red of desire, the eternity symbol above his head, and the four suites of mental expression, basically, or consciousness expression, sorry, not mental, on the table. And we've got it assigned to number one. So again, the wands of spirit, of will, of desire, the cups of feeling and emotions, the swords of mental activity and thought, and the pentacles of physical action, choices in the physical realm, and effecting physical change. So it's a beautiful card. Let's have a look at the number one and what that number one means. And I am pulling my trusty book called, in English, I don't know, but it's written, if you Google it, by Faith Javain and Dusty Bunker. It's the Handbook of Numerology. I've had it forever. It's one of the best books, I find. So I keep going back to it. So let's see what the number one means. Number one is for the masculine principle. And the masculine principle, right in the first sentence, it says so much, because in the world of energy, we're not thinking biology, not yet. We're thinking energy, and masculine energy moves forward and extends outward, right? And so this is already, you know, this is an energy. The Magician extends outward. It's an active energy. It takes action, takes charge, takes control, moves, is in movement. Masculine is also a movement. This number is the pioneer. It's standing independently on its own, on the search for experience that will create a unique identity. It is developing its own gifts, its own talents, and it's discovering the limits of what it can do. It is primal energy. It's positive. It's creative. It's in constant movement. Remember what I said about movement, guys. Movement is life. Everything that is alive moves. And what happens to movement, or through movement? Change, right? Changes occur. So the one is alone, and because it's alone and it's so creative, it has to learn to make decisions where it's going to express its energy and invest its energy. And in that sense, once it makes a decision to create and invest, it's taking control over, and it has to have expressed the courage to continue in that direction without fear of repercussions or blocks or anything like that. So the one is really representative of humanity. Remember these archetypes that we're looking at here. These archetypes are archetypes because they're higher expressions of being. They are the fundamental, the foundational expressions through which consciousness itself flows into expressing itself in the lower realms. So these are experiences that everybody, every single person in this realm is going to be able to connect to. This is an energy that depicts or shows actually mind itself. The magician shows mind itself, right? So not your personal mind, right? But mind itself. And it comes right after the fool. So it's the next level of consciousness after the fool. So we have the fool that just shoots into being and doesn't really recognize itself. It doesn't see any difference or distinction between itself and other, between here and there, whatever. It just is, and it's just flowing through the universe. But here in the next level of consciousness, it's recognizing, oh, wait a minute, I exist. This is where the mind of humanity is born, or the mind of the experience in this level of consciousness, this realm, this dimension, right? Be it human or not human, I guess, I don't know. But it feels, it's very primal, and it's also the level that Eckhart Tolle talks about in his book, The Power of Now, or in his meditations, that level of observing, right? So the level of the watcher. So the magician is often used to depict our personal minds, but it's actually not. It's depicting that mind itself, right? And so that part of you that resides on a higher level that is connected to the all that is, and that is observing. Remember quantum physics? By way of observation, we affect change, right? So this is that part which affects change as to your entire life experience through its observation and its focused intention, right? So this is not about what happens to you in the grocery store. However, your mind, your little mind, can mold itself along this archetype, right? And learn to harness the same powers that this archetype is harnessing, right? So then it's about, when it's about you, it's about the grocery store. But talking about this archetype, it's not. It's about the entire life experience of humanity, and this consciousness, this awareness, directing its focus and its intention and attention towards a certain goal, which affects the changes. The magician is like a catalyst. And remember, catalysts, they affect change without themselves being changed. And now we're diving deeper into the essence of what divinity is, and the essence of God. So the magician can be also seen as God itself, or what we term God is. The fool came out of something that is indescribable, that we cannot even fathom, that we can't depict, that we can't nothing, right? So the first step it takes is organization after it flows into this matrix, right? It organizes itself along the matrix and the energy. And that's the first layer of consciousness that is aware of I am, I exist. So this is not the same I am as it would be of God itself. In A Course in Miracles, it is spoken of that God isn't aware that we exist, or that level of divinity. I'm using the terminology interchangeably, so that may be confusing to some of you. But I'm going to split it up from now on. So when I'm talking from wherever the fool is coming, that we cannot describe, that we cannot name, that we cannot see, that we cannot give any form or shape to, right? I'll call it divinity, okay? Even that is there's nothing in our realm of existence or experience that could possibly even come close to describing that, right? So that has to be said for it. So the fool comes in out of whatever that is, and then it forms itself into what we describe as divinity, the creative principle, which would be the God principle. Now, when we send prayers up to heaven, we think that we're sending it up to God. We're sending up to this highest level of consciousness, right? That's where we're sending it up to. And if our prayers are in alignment with what it is observing for us to happen and experience, then our prayers come true. If not, then we'll have to, you know, accept, surrender, and restructure, right? So this is all happening in divine God rhythm. Sorry, not divine, I'm interchanging again, language, but we'll get to that. This is what this is about, is language with the magician. We'll get to it. So So what the Course in Miracles is stating is that because divinity, or where this all flows from, is in a state of perpetual oneness, it cannot acknowledge separation, right? So to hear a prayer, it would have to acknowledge separation, but it can't. There's just no way. But this layer of consciousness, if you wanted to call it that, that's moving into this recognition of I am, so speak, if I am, then that is, it recognizes prayer, right? Because it is what is creating this whole division. And so when we pray, it doesn't go all the way where we think it goes. It stops at a certain level of consciousness. It moves through different levels of consciousness and then stops. And so if it's in alignment, what we're asking for with what we're meant to receive by way of intention and observation of this watcher consciousness that is observing all of this, then yes, it will, you know, because that intention is then laid. But if it's not, then we have to relearn. So we have this layer as well. This is the layer that Eckhart Tolle, like I said, is talking about when you go into meditation, and you get to that point where you are observing, being observed, right? And it's really hard to get into words. It's really hard to formulate because we just don't have a language that is spiritual, right? So it's hard to put concepts and ideas and feelings into these vehicles that aren't designed to describe that layer or level of consciousness. And that's exactly what the magician is about. So interesting. But anyhow, the magician is that part of your consciousness which holds a supreme intention, right? So it's not your immediate day-to-day consciousness. We use this in readings for that. So a lot of people get confused. But remember, this is an archetypal energy, right? So this is the flow behind the flow behind the flow behind the flow that is observing, watching, and intending, but not actively taking part. It's by way of its intention, right? What is about this magician? As I move through the cards, which all I picked these cards because they show different aspects, but they all fuse to the whole, so I'll try to stay in track and try to stay in line as we move through. The next card that I wanted to show you is this one. It's coming from the Sacred India Tarot, and this tarot is really intense. I use it for myself for meditation, but not really for readings. And it's describing the one second here. So, okay. So this card is depicting Vishnu, the god Vishnu. I won't get too much into this, otherwise this can lead off into all kinds of directions. So Vishnu is he who pervades, is the power that stabilizes and preserves the universe. Is immobile, yet is pervasive because he is everywhere simultaneously in the perpetual motion that appears as stillness to the human eye. It's ascribed to the tattva of the Akash, or the Akasha tattva, and that means space. Everything exists within the space, and space exists in everything. Akasha Tattva is the first and foremost creation of the Supreme. It is the basis of spirituality. It has no limits. It makes us realize the eternal characteristic of the divine, the tattva that connects to the divine and his attributes. Then, what are tattvas? Tattvas are qualities in the body and in all matter, so earth, water, fire, air, and ether. These are the same elements known to Hermetic science and Chinese medicine. The five earthly tattvas are qualities in our senses and in our worlds, and these five tattvas engage three types of behaviors or qualities called gunas that determine the altitude and attitude of your life. So that's a pretty concise explanation. You can look it up. So the five tattvas, the first one would be earth, which they associate with greed, water with lust, fire with anger, air with attachment, and the fifth is ether, and that has to do with negative ego or pride. So instead of being an egomaniac, identify yourself with the infinite, having pride and have pride and gratitude that God made you a human. So this is This is the negative side of the expression of the magician energy, would be excessive pride, excessive ego, excessive focus on desires, selfish desires, right? But we'll move into that. We'll get into that. So what this is, what they associate it with in this card is the karma of Prarabdha and Purushartha. I hope I pronounced that properly. But by Purushartha, which is effort, we may be in a position to change our Prarabdha, fate. So it's, I'm not going to get into the various karma, but karma is not as simplistic as we're used to speaking of it, of just, you know, what goes around comes around and so on and so forth. It's a little bit more than that, and I invite you to dive into that and research the various kinds of karma and the various kinds of ways to flow with that, right, and to work with them. But let's just say that this one has been associated with a karma of effort to produce change in fate. Interesting. So we're already moving away from, or moving deeper than what we usually associate the magician with, which is usually, you know, working magic and setting intentions and all of that. So this is really focusing in on the consciousness, right? Consciousness itself is the magician in these cards, right? Consciousness itself, the magician is here created or depicted as a creative energy. But it may not simply be a creative energy just based on know-how. It's like the creative energy that emanates creativity, that how should I put this? That creates just by way of observing and setting an intention. That's it. That's it. And harnessing the fires, the different aspects of mind, of consciousness flow, right? So harnessing emotion, harnessing mental activity, harnessing will, harnessing thoughts, right? Harnessing, and that's how you harness everything that happens in the material world. I had a vision a long time ago where I was an angel, and I was in this circle of angels, and it was multi-layered, right? And all we were doing was singing around the Godhead, and it was so beautiful, and the song was just flowing out of us. And as the song flew out of us, it twirled and swirled, and it created entire galaxies and worlds and flowers and petals and mountains and valleys and created all these things. But we didn't care, we just kept singing, because for us it was about this song, the song of adoration to life itself. And what the vibrations of that created were of no concern to us whatsoever. So this is what that magician represents, is that kind of energy, is just this creative energy that is out of intention and observation, but without judgment. Still, we're still not in the realm of judging, we're still not in the realm of dividing up, let's say. We're still in that realm of just looking at what there is and observing, but not really, it's very archetypal, so it's very hard to pull down into our realms, right? But we have this layer within us as well, and you can reach it through meditation, where you simply move into that consciousness of observation without a selfish desire. Okay, so then it says here as well that a new level of stability emerges which transcends and includes the old paradigm. He is Vishnu, he who sustains but is not the status quo. His responsibility is to preserve cosmic equilibrium. His tools are change, evolution, transcendence, and trickery if need be. Hence the famous cunning of Vishnu, a quicksilver swiftness of intellect that is without sentimentality and reverence for ossified traditions, a ruthless cutting through all beliefs and habits that are decrepit and no longer serving the purpose of evolution. He is the problem solver par excellence. So that's another topic that is brought up that I really want to address, is sentimentality, reverence for ossified traditions. So much of what we are is traditions and culture, right? So these are levels of consciousness that the magician also addresses. So it's not just us personally, it's also everything that has to do with humanity, with consciousness itself, right? So tradition is a big part of who we are. I'd say personally, it's about 80%, if not more, right? How I talk, how I speak, how I express myself, all realms of the magician, right? Has to do with culture, right? How I move my eyes, how I move my head, how I move my hands, how I intone the words, that even is culture, right? What I talk about, what I observe, what I see to speak of, that has a lot to do with culture, right? So not only the culture of our society, right, but also of course family culture. So we have to move through what we do to ourselves, how we program ourselves. Then we have to move through our family programming. Then we move through our cultural programming. And when we break free of that, right, we're moving further out into true liberation. Now, culture is important. Culture is beautiful, right? To maintain a certain way of seeing things, cooking things, dressing, you know, all of that, behaviorisms. But when it gets to a point where it's stuck and it's ossified and it's run its course, we have to bring it into movement. So I invite those of you that are really into your cultures to, you know, contribute to it moving, because like we said before with the Fool and at the beginning of this video, everything that is alive moves, and movement is change. Change is not always bad. It's not always evil. It's not always negative, right? It's necessary for something to stay alive, to stay in tune with the level of awareness and consciousness that that is actually supposed to flow through it. It's like some cultures are like driving old cars from 1920, you know, when you could be driving the Porsche. Like, why not upgrade it, you know? It's cute, right? But it's the vehicle has to match the consciousness that is being flowed through or poured through it. And so some cultures, I feel like they need an upgrade, plain and simple, you know? So it's good to stay in connection with your roots, but at the same time it's about growth. And for me, true necromancy is worshiping that which is dead, which is worshiping old stuff, right? Old paradigms and old cultures that are no longer like really efficient vehicles for the consciousness that is looking to seeking to flow through it. So that's the magician as well, is being able to clearly cut through this and carve new pathways, carve new expressions. Okay, this is the card of the. I'll read this later, but we're gonna move forward a little bit faster because I know some of you are already like, oh my God. So let's move into the Crowley definition. And I love the Crowley. And so we have here, in the old Crowley tarot, there were three magicians, but in this in the newer ones, I think they just throw in one version. So here he's talking about the depiction of communication, the ability to communicate itself. That's what the magician represents to the Crowley tarot. So I'm going to switch the camera so you can see all the little symbols. Okay, so we're back. So here on this card, we see Hermes, which is the messenger of the gods, right? So messages are communication. So communication that inspires, that is, you know, creative, that inspires to create, so on and so forth. So here we have Hermes dancing in. We'll start here at the left. So the first symbol is it represents our ability to communicate around manifesting, around physical things, around financial things, you know, if you want to take it to that level. But it's mainly about the physical experience, the physical plane, and our ability to communicate about that. Then there's the lantern or the floating cherub. And that stands for communication that inspires, that awakens the genius in us, the creative being in us. Then we've got this ibis or phoenix in the hand of the magician is a symbol to communicate about religious principles, spiritual principles. Then we've got the arrow up here, which is indicating that it's that direct and honest communication to the right time is floating here. Then we've got the Eye of Horus that stands for articulate and inspired vision or ability to visualize. Then we've got the floating roll or script that stands for the power of the written word. Then we've got the egg and the egg here and the wings, and that stands for a memory that all, or a reminder that all communication comes out of our deep inner being, and that it's always transforming or being transformed. And then we have this cup with a snake that describes the transformational ability of communication and how transforming it can be to communicate your feelings, what you feel, and the truth of that. And then we have the sword, which is a direct, again, another direct communication, which shows that we are able to express our thoughts and ideas clear and to the point. And then we've got this is a golden monkey, which represents the Egyptian god of wisdom, Thoth, that transformed himself into a golden monkey to show that communication has to be flexible and that we should use all channels of communication in a flexible way to effect the changes that we need in the world around us, right? So those are the channels of communication. So let me switch. Another important thing with the magician is that it holds a connection to the aces, the four aces, and the four tens in the minor arcana. So the four aces would be Ace of Swords, Ace of Pentacles, Ace of Cups, and Ace of Wands. So the Ace of Wands would be pure will, knowing what it is that you want. The Ace of Swords would be pure thought, pure thinking. The Cups would be pure feeling, knowing what it is that you feel. And when you're in complete clarity, then you have the Ace of Pentacles, which is pure creation. The Tens would be what is blocking that flow of energy or supporting that flow of energy. So supporting would be, of course, the Ten of Cups, which is emotional freedom, emotional flow, feeling in alignment, feeling in harmony, knowing of the benefit that this working will do, which will bring it to the Ten of Pentacles, which is expressing itself completely, right? So the Ten of Pentacles is the complete lasting expression. The Ten of Swords is, one block is fear of failure, fear of doubt, fear of fear through doubt, fear of things not working out. The Ten of Wands would be a restriction through blocking off what it is that you truly desired, blocking off that creative impulse. So then it's also associated with the Wheel of Fortune, but we'll get there. So the Crowley Tarot is basically showing how we are master creators by our ability to communicate, and that communication is key. Communication is all we need to be able to create, right? But it's not about necessarily communicating on the outside, but communicating within all aspects of your being, clearly, authentically visualizing what is being said from another aspect of your being, so that there are no hidden parts within your being, so that everything is communicating clearly, and that way everything can sing a clear song and really manifest on the outside what it is that is intended, right? But the song has to come from the soul, right? Or what we call the soul, or from the deepest layer, deepest aspect of your being. So with that communication, right, we're being reminded to, with the four aces, have a clear idea of what it is that we want, clear feeling and clear intention with the wands, and then we can plant a clear seed, Ace of Pentacles, of what it is that we desire. And to keep in mind the two blocks of the Ten of Swords, fear, doubt, negativity, fear of failure, Ten of Wands, repressing our true will, pushing it down, shoving it aside. And also the two gifts of the Ten of Cups, which is abundant feeling, a feeling joyful, feeling elevated, and the Ten of Discs, which is what we end up creating, the Ten of Pentacles, which is something stable, lasting, and here in this reality, right? So the real focus of the Magician is not to evoke some magical powers working with all four different elements. It's harnessing our own abilities to feel, to think, to desire, to create, to make, right? And through that, and communicating with all parts of our being inside our own selves, right? So what I mean by that, I'll show you in this little example. Let's say you're the light is your circle of consciousness, right? So the light is your consciousness. And let's say you're 5 years old and you have a problem with mom and dad, okay? Something's happening there. So wait, let me take this one instead. I'm gonna use Arthur. Everybody say hi to Arthur. I'm gonna work with Arthur. He's perfect. So yeah, now you guys can see him. Okay, so let's say you have a problem with mom or dad, but you can't deal with it. You're 5 years old. So you push it out to the edges of your awareness. You ignore it, you know, and time passes. As time passes, you're no longer seeing it, right? When you push it out. So it's no longer a problem to you, you think, but it's still very conscious. It's just that you don't see it. So it's still working away in your life, you know. You're not noticing or realizing it. You're not aware. And as you grow older, as your consciousness grows and you get to know more aspects of yourself, more areas of yourself, look what happens. It comes back in. But now, right, because your consciousness has grown, now you see that problem again. It's stepped into your space as a relationship, maybe a teacher, maybe your children, maybe a marriage, right? But there you are dealing with that same issue again. So, and this is what that communication is all about, is communicating with all aspects of your being and being truthful. So truth is really important, because you're not pushing anything away because you can't deal with it. You're not in denial. You're not in spiritual bypassing. You're not in any of that. But you're looking it square in the eye and saying, this is what it is. And this is the only way you can have clear, authentic communication within your own being. Be a completely clear-minded, clear-intentioned, clear feeling in order to create something beautiful, magnificent, and clear, right? So all of that has to be seen. And we have to recognize all layers. So that layer of programming, which we ourselves created, which our families created, which society created, and only when we step out of that, which our culture created, our times, only when we step out of that are we really like this eternal dancing being, right? That is dancing on the edges of time. So enjoy. Moving on. Hey, so we continue. Okay, so the next cards that I wanted to focus in on depicting the Magician are the three by Brian Lahr and the Wizard of Oz. You guys know I love these cards. Yeah. So anyways, he has three different versions. So the physical Magician, the mental, and the spiritual. I'm gonna keep this one to work with, because it has the same symbols, all of them. The only difference is the energetic depiction. So the lost my train of thought. You can see Mercury here, so it's brought into connection with the planet Mercury. But also what's important, what I want to focus in on, is this rune. Of course, he has the sigil and he has the Hebrew letter that it's also associated with, as well. The elements and so on and so forth. But anyways, the rune is Rido, or R. And the R rune, or Rido, is really interesting because it's the first rune of movement. It shows movement, intentional, controlled movement. That's what it really means. It's the root of the word Rad in German, which means wheel in English. And it symbolizes, the traditional meaning of this rune is to ride, so riding. And it's brought in connection with poems, verses in Icelandic or Nordic poetry. I won't get into this. Oh, why do I do this? I need a script to like really read off of. But I keep going off track. But anyways, it's brought in connection with poetry from old Nordic poetry that talks about writing, talks about movement, and that is why. So anyways, it's talking about controlled movement. It's talking about moving, that first initiation of movement, the first turn of the wheel. Speaking of the wheel, this is also the Wheel of Fortune is connected with the Magician, but we'll get to that when I get there. I keep doing this. I can't help it. I'm sorry. Anyways, but there are lots of correlations and connections throughout the entire system, so that's why. But the wheel in this movement, it stands for a lot of things, right? So movement in many different levels. So literal movement, but also movement through consciousness, through the worlds that we inhabit. It's usually depicted as a also, how should I put this? It can also be seen in the wheel itself. So the classic wheel that was used in ancient German symbology, Germanic, right, or Nordic, was a wheel with 8 spokes. And these 8 spokes were intentional because they reminded of the 8 directions, the 8 heavenly directions, and the four main seasons in the year, and the four main directions, so north, south, east, and west, right? So it also, when you have those 8 spokes, you also have the 12 houses, right? The 12 houses of a astrology chart. Gosh, dang it! This is so hard to like, because reading, translating it from the German is a little difficult. So anyways, they're talking about that wheel and how the wheel is like the basis for spiritual mind movement, but also literal movement. And yeah, how important that is. So let me look up rune magic and how is this wheel used. It gives you the ability to exert control in situations or take the initiative. It holds the power to control a situation, to bring order into chaos, to put things under your own will. It gives you the ability to be master of the situation, and stands in connection with one of the principles of Telema, which is every man and woman is a star. It motivates, it inspires you to go your own way, and it can be worked with to bring movement to or move things out of the way that are blocking in order to direct the flow of energy in a certain direction. So the god that lords over this rune is Thor, and his primary element is fire. The secondary element is air. So that means fire that expresses itself through air. In other words, intuition and enthusiasm that expresses itself through intellect and willpower. So that is that. Okay, guys. So how do we bring this into readings, and how do we tie this in? The Magician, often when it shows up in readings, it's not really a time card. If it were, it would be now, right? So the eternal now, the eternal present. It usually, with the number one, it can depict one of anything. So one day, year, month, you name it, whatever you ascribe it to. But it usually depicts a high state of energy, sustained application of will and imagination, juggling with many things at once, movement. It can show travel, flexibility, curiosity, dexterity, a wicked sense of humor, sarcasm, very high intelligence, personal initiative, self-confidence, creative abilities, determination, power, overachievers, the ability to manifest, the consultant, the expert, heightened attractiveness or attractivity, and to the opposite sex, right? strong elements of searching for meanings and higher personal purpose, business and career success, persuasive, fluent speakers, organizational skills, networking. On the flip side, we're also talking here of the trickster, someone who's a con artist, someone who's who lies, right? Thieves, steals, stuff like that. So that kind of energy, the very deceptive energy, not truthful energy. A key to this card is truth, authenticity and truth. So that's one of the main keys that is ascribed to this card as well. Okay, I hope that helped. I hope it wasn't too confusing. It was, for some reason, it was very difficult because the Magician is all about communication. So of course I would be learning about communication, how to communicate certain concepts effectively. Don't forget to leave your comments in the box below and stay tuned for tomorrow because we'll be dealing with a High Priestess, which is another interesting card. If you would like a personal reading with me, then of course you know where to go. The link is also in the box below. And otherwise, I'm wishing you a wonderful day. Take care.